Gastro-Intestinal Physiology. Here, we will be discussing the important aspects of digestive system and how things work out in the gut. The gastrointestinal tract or the alimentary canal, along with other accessory organs, helps in the process of digestion and absorption. Our GI tract has two major functions, the secretion and the motility. We'll be discussing both these functions in detail and talking about each of them separately. So we'll be starting with GI secretions. GI secretions basically occur at three places along the gastrointestinal tract, the saliva, the gastric, and the pancreas. Salivary secretions occur in the mouth. The gastric secretions, they occur in the stomach, and pancreatic secretions occur in the pancreas. Now the gastric secretions, they are maximum in amount, about 1.5 to 2 liters per day. So we have gastric secretions, which are maximum in amount, and about 1.5 liters to 2 per day. And they are the most acidic also. The pH of gastric secretions ranges between 1.5 to 3. So pH is 1.5 to 3. Coming to the pancreatic secretions are alkaline due to the presence of these bicarbonate ions. HCO3 is bicarbonate, and this makes the secretions alkaline, and the pH is about 8.3. So now we'll move on to saliva and discuss it further. In saliva, we have about three important salivary glands, which are the major salivary glands. We also have a few minor salivary glands. I'll only be discussing the major ones and talking about them. So the first one is the parotid. Parotid is the largest salivary gland. The secretions are about 20% of the total. And the salivary gland, the parotid salivary gland, empties in the oral cavity by the Stenson's duct. So this is important that it empties in the Stenson's duct. Next we have the submandibular or the submaxillary salivary gland, and they form the major part of the secretion, that is about 70%. And this one drains into the Wharton's duct. So this one drains into Wharton's duct. And lastly we have the sublingual gland. Sublingual is the smallest of all salivary glands and consists of only 10% of the total salivary secretion. And this one pours its content into the ducts of Ravenous. Now we'll come to the functions of saliva. Now, saliva basically has three important functions. The first one is the most important from digestive point of view, and which is that it aids in the digestion of carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins. Carbohydrates is digested with the help of serum amylase. This serum amylase is also known as ptyalin. So this is important that the other name of serum amylase is ptyalin. And carbohydrate digestion, 5% of the total carbohydrate digestion occurs in the saliva. Next we have lipids. Lipids are digested with the help of lingual lipase. And third, this is a very important point, which is that proteins, there is no enzyme which is there for the digestion of proteins in saliva. So proteins are not digested in saliva. So this should be kept in mind, because when we talk about gastric secretions, we'll see that there are some few differences related to this. Now we'll move on to the next part. The second function of saliva is that of lubrication, which is self-explanatory. And the third is of protection. So saliva has secretory IgAs, which aid in protection. Then we have lactoferrin, which is basically an antibacterial. So this also aids in protection. And then we have certain lysozymes, which also help in protection. Now we'll move on to regulation of the salivation. So regulation is under the control of autonomic nervous system. And this autonomic nervous system, along with the nervous mechanism, regulates the salivary secretion. So ANS, and it's totally neural. Then we have, under autonomic nervous system, we have sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. The important point here is that both sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system, they increase salivation. So both of them, they are not antagonistic in function, but here in the saliva, in the regulation of salivation, they both act on increasing the salivation. The only difference is that when sympathetic nervous system is more active, the saliva becomes thick and copious. And when we have a parasympathetic nervous system to be more active, the saliva is thin and watery. Other than that, both of them help in increasing the salivation. So this is about regulation of salivation. We'll move on further. We'll be talking about gastric secretions now. So gastric glands basically are tubular structures made up of different type of cells. So these different type of cells, they secrete the gastric juice. So gastric secretions occur by stimulation of cells in the stomach and they'll secrete gastric juice. Now here is a diagram of the stomach and we have different cells and I'll be telling you the function of all these cells. So the first one is the surface cell. Surface cell basically, as the name suggests, it secretes mucus. So it is responsible for secreting mucus. Another cells we have here are the neck cells. These neck cells are stem cells. So from these stem cells or the neck cells, new cells arise. Next we have a very important cell, which is the parietal cell. Now parietal cell has two important aspects, two important things which it produces. One is the gastric acid. The gastric acid is secreted by, The gastric acid is secreted by the parietal cells. And another thing we have is the intrinsic factor. The intrinsic factor, which is secreted by the parietal cells, the B12. So it's very important to remember that parietal cells secrete gastric acid and the intrinsic factor B12. Another type of cells we have is the enterochromaffin-like cells. Now these enterochromaffin-like cells or the ECL cells, they basically are histamine-producing cells. They are histamine-producing cells. And these ECL cells, they also have another function, which is increasing the gastric acid production. So gastric acid is being produced by parietal cells, but ECL or the histamine producing cells are increasing the gastric acid production. So this is important. Now we'll move on to the chief cells. Now chief cells here, they're the deepest of all. They lie deepest as compared to all the cells. And these chief cells, they produce pepsinogen. They produce pepsinogen. And this pepsinogen, with the help of gastric acid, is converted to pepsin. So pepsin is converted by pepsinogen in the presence of gastric acid, which is being secreted here by the parietal cells. So this will give you a complete idea of which produces what and where it is being used. So parietal cells are producing gastric cells. And how are they getting used? They are getting used in the digestion of proteins by pepsin, because when chief cells, they produce pepsin, it is not in the active form. It is inactive in the form of pepsinogen, and gastric acids are responsible for activating them. Clear? So we'll move further. Now gastric digestion, we'll talk about gastric digestion next. So we'll see that carbohydrates are not digested by the gastric secretions. In the saliva, if you remember, in the saliva we saw that proteins were not getting digested. Proteins were not getting digested. Here, gastric secretion, carbohydrates are not getting digested. Now lipids are digested with the help of gastric lipase and proteins with the help of pepsin that we saw that was activated with the help of gastric acid. Now we'll move on to the phases of gastric digestion. Now basically secretion of gastric juice is a continuous process, but the quantity varies depending upon the time and stimulus. So the quantity will vary as per the time and stimulus. And because of that, we have three phases: cephalic, gastric, and intestinal. In cephalic phase, as the name suggests, the stimulus is arising from the cephalus or the head region. And here, we do not have any food present. So no food is present and still the gastric juices are being secreted. And that is why it is also known as the appetite juice. So it is also known as appetite juice. but food is not present. Next, we have the gastric phase. The gastric phase will begin when food enters the stomach. Begins after food enters stomach. And this obviously forms the major part of the gastric secretion. And last, we have the intestinal phase. In intestinal phase, secretion of gastric juice, I'm writing GJ for short, when chyme enters the intestine. Enters intestine. So these are the three phases of gastric digestion, and all these three phases are under the nervous and the hormonal control. So both nervous and hormonal control are responsible for these phases. And also, the cephalic phase consists of 20% of the total secretion. And obviously, gastric will be the maximum, so it is around 70% of the total. And intestinal, we have 10%. Okay, so we'll move on to the next part. Next is the pancreatic secretions. Pancreas basically has dual function, the endocrine function and the exocrine function. We have pancreas as having both the functions, the endocrine and the exocrine. But here, we will be talking about the exocrine part of the pancreas. The endocrine is associated with hormonal, and that will be taken up in the hormone when we study the hormones. So here we have digestion, and in pancreas, the digestion of carbohydrate, lipid and proteins, all three of them take place. Carbohydrates is with the help of pancreatic amylase. Lipids is the help of pancreatic lipase and colipase. And proteins, trypsinogen and chymotrypsinogen. But these trypsinogen and chymotrypsinogen, they are inactive when they are present in the pancreas. They become active only when they reach the small intestine. Now, why is that so? It is because this inactivity is because that if they are active, then they can auto-digest the pancreas. So they are inactive to prevent the auto-digestion of pancreas, which is very important to know. Auto-digestion of pancreas. And they will become active only when they reach the small intestine. And when they are active, they're also known as zymogens. So these trypsinogen and chymotrypsinogen, they are also known as zymogens. Right, S here. Okay. So how will they become active in the pancreas? They'll become active, in the small intestine, they will become active with the help of an enzyme which is known as succus entericus. So trypsinogen with the help of succus entericus in small intestine will convert to trypsin. So this happens in the small intestine. Next, we'll move on to the pancreatic secretions. Now, pancreatic secretions we have, which is regulated by hormones. So we have two of them. One is the CCK-PZ or cholecystokinin pancreozymin. This cholecystokinin pancreozymin is secreted by eye cells. This is very important. A lot of times it has been asked that eye cells secrete what, or CCK-PZ is secreted by what. So eye cells secrete CCK-PZ, and another is the secretin. This secretin is known as the natural antacid. Now, why is it known as natural antacid? Is because the pancreatic juice is poor in enzymes, but it is rich in bicarbonate. So the pancreatic juice is poor in enzymes, but it has more bicarbonates. As I told you that pancreatic secretions are alkaline. So when acid is present, it stimulates the secretin. So in the presence of acid, secretin will be stimulated and it will curb the acidity. So that is why it is known as natural antacid. And another interesting fact about secretin is that it was the first hormone which was discovered. It was discovered by scientists named Bayliss and Starling. So Bayliss and Starling discovered secretin, and it was incidentally the first hormone to be discovered. Now we'll move on to the next part. The next part is the gastrointestinal motility. We are done with the secretion part of the gastrointestinal tract. Now we'll move on to the motility of the gastrointestinal tract. So when there is presence of food, that is known as fed state. And where there is absence of food, that is known as the fasting state. This is simple. So, two different types of movements are seen as per the state. If it's fed state, there will be another movement. If it's fasting state, there will be another movement. So, we'll start with fed state movement pattern. Now, what happens in fed state? As the food moves into the GI tract, the area which is before the food, that is the previous area where food was present and it just moved here. So, that area contracts. And the area which is after the food, where is the food is supposed to go, that area will relax. So, there will be contraction of this area and the food is there and this area will get relaxed. So, this movement is known as peristalsis. And obviously, as you can see, this sort of movement will help the food to move further. So, this is known as peristalsis, peristaltic movement, which is seen in the fed state. Now, the contraction occurs with the help of these substances, acetylcholine and substance P, and relaxation occurs with the help of nitric oxide. Now, another very important concept here is that acetylcholine and nitric acid, they are equal in number, like the amount of acetylcholine and the amount of nitric acid, they both are dependent on each other. So, if there is a loss of nitric oxide due to any reason, then the acetylcholine will increase to keep up the equilibrium. If there is a loss of NO, then acetylcholine will increase to keep up the equilibrium and vice versa. And this loss of nitric oxide will affect the lower esophageal sphincter. LES is lower esophageal sphincter. So this lower esophageal sphincter, if it remains prolonged in a state of prolonged contraction, then we will have what is known as aplasia cardia. Aplasia cardia occurs due to the prolonged contraction of LES, and that occurs because of loss of nitric oxide, which results in the increase of acetylcholine. Okay, so this is important. Another thing is that here again we'll see that we have acetylcholine and nitric oxide, and if nitric oxide is getting reduced due to any reason, here we have it being destroyed by a parasite. So again we'll see that LES contracted and acetylcholine increase, and this will lead to pseudoachalasia, because this parasite is what is known as Trypanosoma cruzi. So this parasite is Trypanosoma cruzi, and this will lead to the contraction of the lower esophageal sphincter, and this will cause what is known as the Chagas disease. And this is known as pseudoachalasia, because it is not true achalasia cardia. It is occurring because of a parasite, and this is pseudoachalasia. Now we'll move on to the fasting state movement pattern. Now during the fasting state, the movement pattern that is seen is the MMC, migratory motor complex. This MMC occurs once in 90 minutes. Okay. Now how will it happen is, this is stomach, this is the colon. Okay, so this is the food bolus, the remaining food bolus. Like most of the food has passed in the fed state. We had seen that it has passed with the help of peristalsis in the fed state. Now whatever undigested food that is remaining there, that will be swept towards the colon to clean up the tract. So this will occur like in one sweep, which takes about 90 minutes, and it will reach here, and again there will be one clean sweep in 90 minutes, and then again it will move ahead. So this is known as the MMC, and this MMC is regulated by a hormone which is known as motilin, as the name suggests. Okay, so we are done with the motility. Now we have something called the enteric nervous system. Now enteric nervous system is very important, and it is also known as little brain. It forms a very small part of the GI tract, and it basically has two functions. One is of secretion control and other is the motility control. So we have secretion control and the motility control. The secretion control is by the submucosal plexus, which are also known as the Meissner's plexus. So these Meissner plexus, they basically lie in between the muscular layer and the submucosal layer. So they lie between the muscular layer and submucosal layer. That is where they lie, and they are responsible for the secretion control. Okay, S for secretion, S for submucosal. Next we have the motility control. The motility control is done by myenteric plexus or the oblax plexus. M for motility, M for myenteric. So this, and where does it lie? It lies between the inner circular muscle layer and the outer longitudinal muscle layer. Inner circular muscle layer and outer longitudinal muscle layer. Longitudinal muscle layer. So this is about the enteric nervous system, and thus this pretty much sums up our gastrointestinal physiology. Thank you so much for watching, and do not forget to share and subscribe. Thank you.